news today, Ministry of Foreign Affairs consider UNICEF report on children's welfare. New research highlights air pollution concerns. Training on gender, power relations and violence against women ends. First ever New Zealand festival in Honiara. And in sports, national under 16 girls football team's progression on to the next stage in the championship. Hello and welcome, I'm Lisa Ossifello. A new UNICEF report highlights severe challenges facing children in Pacific nations like Fiji, Samoa, the Solomon Islands and Vanuatu. As parents leave for seasonal work in Australia and New Zealand, children face disrupted family lives, failing education standards and worsening mental health. Many take on caregiving roles affecting their schooling and well-being. Educators report declining literacy rates and rising mental health issues. Financial instability and misuse of remittances further hinder children's access to education and healthcare.
This children's issue is basically everywhere now. We have children, even coming to school or secondary schools, we have got bored too. We are first a least developed country. We can try to manage things, but the only strength that we have is basically the social security that we have. Unlike Okatanara Savala countries, we do not rely too much on nuclear family. Basically rely on extended family. So sometimes Okata multilateral report we have got doing here. Okata need to really understand the culture that exists also. But we are not saying that there is no problem. Every situation does have its problems, and certainly not only dealing with children, dealing with family itself. This is basically something that we continue to deal with in life. But certainly, I think right now, hemno kasim stage where we would say there is a crisis. We are making mivala stop to take stock of him.
UNICEF urges Pacific governments to implement pre-departure training for workers, enhance child protection systems and establish support networks for affected children. Recent research has revealed concerning levels of air pollution and its effects on young people. Gina Kikea with this report.
Air quality studies have raised serious concerns about the impact of airborne pollutants on children. The research shows that concentrations of PM2.5, which are tiny particles found in smoke, have frequently exceeded the World Health Organization's recommended limits. These particles are especially harmful because they can penetrate deep into the lungs and bloodstreams. The World Health Organization estimates that over 90% of children globally are exposed to harmful air pollution levels, leading to about 600,000 deaths every year. In the Solomon Islands, children face a high rate of lower respiratory infections, with an incidence of 774 cases per 1,000 children under 5 years. Almost half of all lower respiratory illnesses cases in children can be attributed to household air pollution.
In particular, most households still using firewood for cooking. So that one fell out of our local sources contributing to local air pollution, waste burning. Yeah, in fact, during my household survey last year, most houses said that lots are practicing the waste burning laws, and that too contribute to local air pollution. Now, last year, now that you may understand what ambient air quality and like, me fala come to him just a snapshot, no more study local school beginning in Lohonia, both urban and peri urban. So, you may understand what exposure lo micro level, lo micro environment. So just generally numa kota pikini ni kota mo expose le pollution lo comfort lo homes lo kata which is a concern. And second highest exposure na lo school. And then followed by commuting. The mat travel from school to house and house go back to school. So we are hoping to use this data for emissarism awareness and also start for addressing no other local sources.
Jimmy Healy is a PhD candidate at the School of Civil and Environmental Engineering, whose thesis is on air quality and health risk in the Pacific, focusing on Fiji and the Solomon Islands. Healy was also a recipient of the Australian Government's Research Training Program Scholarship. His PhD project is part of a broader air quality monitoring program in the Pacific in partnership with Pacific governments and universities.
Yeah, data is important. Yeah. Because we need evidence. Yeah. Decision has to be evidence-based. So we need for grab access to data. And not only data, nothing but quality data for informing policy. Now, based on experience, we need air quality monitoring. We will start from scratch. Now. Like little bit of I'm done here and there, like the Pacific, Hawaii, because we got them resource, so we got them stuck research in Hawaii, the Fiji, USP, at the moment, it start for the own research project, air quality, but the region in general start from zero. So now we started them low cost sensors up until the information about equipment this time, for you may start for filling in a data gap. Yeah.
The impact of air pollution on children is alarming, and immediate action is needed to protect their health. The recent report highlights the dangers of PM2.5, tiny airborne particles less than 2.5 micrometers wide. These particles are so small that they can penetrate deep into the lungs and bloodstream, posing serious health risks. By using solid data and acting on key recommendations, the government can address these issues and safeguard the health of our children. Gina Kikia, Tavuli News.
Solomon Islands will host the 54th Pacific Islands Forum Leadership Meeting next year, September, in Honiara. Discussions are currently underway, building on outcomes from the recent meeting in Tonga. Pacific Islands Forum General Secretary Baron Wanga expressed confidence about the upcoming event during this month's press conference.
The 54th meeting in the Solomon Islands will be one that has to build on from Tonga. And as we all know, there were, and everyone was very, very pleased with the arrangements there. And I'm sure that you're going to organize an even more exciting meeting. But the thing is, we have set some standards, and probably with the RRA coming in and keep firming up before the meeting, will ensure that participants attending these are other partners, not members, but like dialogue partners and development partners. We hope that we can continue to attract highest level of participation. When I say that, we mean prime ministers, if they can come, their ministers, or even deputy ministers. We don't want our leaders to sit across the table with junior officers. When I say that, these are public officers from ambassadorial level down. I think the Solomon meeting will maintain that, what's been set in Tonga.
Foreign Affairs Permanent Secretary Colin Beck says that the 54th Pacific Islands Forum is 12 months away, but work on the ground will soon start.
When we're going to host it is in the communique. It's in September, so we're working on that. There are issues leading to that. several things, or same Ocean of Peace Declaration that will be issued in Honiara. Work on that will also be finalized. Reforms below regional architecture, the third phase, that also the outcome more or less will come to the Honiara meeting. But we basically have already tried to set up a task force. I think cabinet is more or less we're seeking cabinet's blessing to do that. We're trying to prepare you know, a little bit more than 12 months before that something. So this is why I think we're paying a lot of close attention to the regional agenda prior to Tonga and Kasem this time. Yeah, we are trying to ensure that you may continue to support Tonga, because the success of Tonga means a success also in Honiara.
The Australia-Solomon Islands Partnership for Justice has organised a significant training event focused on gender, power relations and violence against women. This 3 to 5 day workshop designed to deepen understanding and improve response to these critical issues.
From Law and Justice, when you perpetrate domestic violence, sexual violence or sexual violence against children, it is always your fault.
This training is very important. Yeah, in terms of domestic violence against women, yeah, where it might happen within a society, rate blame them go higher, and that training now am helping trainers for go and do awareness in order for you me survey lessen them gap below inequality against women and domestic violence where it mainly happen with a woman by men perpetrators. So the aim of this training is that we get as much as possible the men, because they are the most perpetrator of domestic violence, so they just come looking. What now? It means to be to give equal opportunities to women. We believe if equal opportunities are given to men, in terms of decision making, in terms of waka, low house, Oh, this small thing here, very important. Yeah, suppose if we give him equality for women, then violence action here, by him less, or either by himself stop, because we supporting women, so that Ogata can same human man too. So they just human as us, So they need equality, equal opportunity, Equal in every means, law society. I think I'm now me like for talent. After training, then the plan is that we will go into our organization and we will include the training as an implementation part. When we will include in training, gender training. Inside law training Kaledablo Mifala, so that we can deliver the training where Mifala come attend him, receive him lawyer as trainers where or the train to go out and train.
Because of this gendering process, we are teaching me that time you come in and you or that fella woman, have no more reason why they can go to house that you make him time you follow now what you like.
Participants from various agencies have gained essential skills and knowledge, preparing them to become effective trainers and advocates within their fields. Today's ceremony marks their achievements and emphasizes the training's impact on advancing gender equality and combating violence against women. For the first time, the New Zealand Festival is being held in Honiara at the Multipurpose Hall. Now, this all-day event will showcase the deep-rooted ties between New Zealand and Solomon Islands, highlighting community partnerships, trade, education links, and shared passion for music, culture, and sports. Attendees can enjoy live music and cultural performances, sports, giveaways, market stalls, and information booths.
So, important for this fella event, him for Somna, partnership between Solomon Islands and New Zealand. And how we for work together with him, a lot of stakeholders and partners, when we for garem, stakeholders of them, Save the Children, World Vision, a lot of different stakeholders, when we for work our community, any kind of different type project, development projects and other projects where him help him to for building Solomon Islands. So this event is mainly for people to come, especially see what New Zealand is doing in the Solomon Islands and how we are partnering with our local stakeholders, and just for everyone to come enjoy what the New Zealand is doing here in the Solomon Islands. So basically, it's we're having the stakeholders stalls, we have food vendors, we have activities for 7 schools where Oketa come and learn them rugby and netball, and then we have the famous bouncy castle, face painting, where everything is indoor, and then we have some of the activities outdoor at the netball court, and then we have entertainment at the main stage, and also at this afternoon Bipala Garem VIP event, where we have VIPs come and testing some fella cheese for New Zealand and wine, and then we have chocolate where New Zealand take cocoa from Yumi Solomon and then go make a cup chocolate, and then by him now the testing here to the cocoa from Solomon Islands where him exported to the New Zealand. Yeah, so it's basically everything that you've seen here is partnership with New Zealand and the Solomon Islands.
World War II may be over many decades ago. Today it is history, or just a story to tell. But 80 years later, parts of the war still remains, and it's the unexploded ordnances and World War II remnants that still pose risks within our country. Barney Paulson, who owns the Peter Joseph Museum in Munda, has a collection of World War II remnants and sees the importance of educating the younger generation to know more about these dangerous unexploded ordnances and the danger it poses if found.
Me like I'm got a people for call looking what got a massive or got a dangerous artifacts or like bombs. Yeah, make him got a look him that if all the look him say, Golobus look him, or got a must be careful to no holy Muslims. So I'm not be 3-4 Bamba or got a must come and look savvy look at the things. So me help him got a picking it too. Mainly for got a must careful. Me for a got a big support Lorenda operation. Mi fala support him this one. Mi fala type of support him. We must get rid with them every dangerous thing. Because some of the bombs are intoxicated. Like got a bomb blasting, but poison. What I got a very strong substances in a lot of the bombs.
During a special visit during Operation Render Safe, Barney Paulson thanked the members of the operation and showcased some of the collections that he has collected over the many years.
When they land on aircraft carrier, they drop it off and just stop it. So like this is BAR, Browning automatic rifle, Japanese Type 96, 50 caliber Yaku, and this was 50 caliber as well, water cool. And these barrels come, so it's Japanese ones, and this is Japanese. This is from the ground to air. This one is built from a Japanese Zero. Pumping out, you know. This one's a Nambu machine gun. And I've got a Nambu pistol here as well. Handgun. And all sorts of, you know, fasteners for the bags.
Operation Render Safe concludes today in the Western Province with a joint multinational combination of 8 countries that have participated with a commitment of removing unexploded ordnances and war remnants to ensure a much safer community with more access to land and food cultivation infrastructure, provide safer environment, and also to improve conditions for economic development. More than 3,000 unexploded ordnances was disposed of during Operation Render Safe and is one of the successful operations, which was done on both land and sea over a time span of 2 weeks. This year, the EOD Department of the Royal Solomon Islands Police Force have disposed over 1,500 bombs in Guadalcanal, Central Islands 56, Choiseul 108, and in the Western Province, they have disposed over 600 bombs.